Hello everybody, I'm Nick, and in this video I'm going to show you one feature that was just added in .NET 7 Preview 3, which is actually the one feature I was missing from minimal APIs. I had everything else, and if they added that one, I would be complete, and now I am, and that feature is filters. Filters were not in minimal APIs in .NET 6 when they launched, and now they are, so you will see how we can now use filters to do some really, really cool stuff and clean up a lot of code that you could argue was a bit dirty pre-filters. If you like the content and you wanna see more, make sure you subscribe, ring the notification bell, and for more training, check out nickchapsas.com. And speaking of nickchapsas.com, I actually have a full From Zero to Hero course on minimal APIs. So to bundle the course with the video, I'm offering you 20% off if you use that discount code. And that course will take you from the very basics of minimal APIs to some really advanced stuff. For those of you who don't know, it is the way I'm building APIs nowadays. I don't use controllers anymore in my own stuff just because of how much more performance I'm getting from minimal APIs and how more simple they are. So if you want to learn how to use them too, check the link down below. So let me show you what I have here. I have a very simple API here built with minimal APIs. And it really has some customer endpoints here. So I have a get to get all customers. I have a get by ID. I have a post to create a customer, and then I have a delete. And this is what the model looks like. Now I also have a validator here using fluent validation, and I'm registering that in my program.cs over here. And then I'm using an actual database. I'm using SQLite with Dapper, and that's it. So let me just quickly run this API just to understand what we're dealing with. So here we go. Let's go to Postman, and I'm going to call the post method to create a new customer. I'm going to create myself. Here you go. I have been created. So if I go ahead and list all customers over here, as you can see, I am being returned. If I copy the ID and I get a customer by ID, I can. If the ID is invalid, then 404, exactly as you'd expect. And then if I go ahead and I delete me by ID, I'm getting a 204, no content. It indicates that the thing was deleted successfully. And if I try again, now I'm getting a 404 because the customer does not exist with that ID. So that's all I have. And as you can see, my database was created here. If I quickly connect just to show you that it is empty, select star from customers. Here we go. Because I deleted the user, there's nothing in the customers table. So that's what we're dealing with here. Now, let me show you what the problem is and the problem I had with minimal APIs as they shipped in .NET 6. If I want to have validation for that specific thing, yes, I am using my customer validator here using fluent validation. And if you don't know what fluent validation is, I do have a video for that. You can check that later. But effectively, it allows us to define in a very nice way the rules for different properties in that object and then run that validation either on request or on demand when we need it. Now, because minimal APIs do not come with a validator out of the box, what we are doing is we're injecting the iValidator in that endpoint here. And then we're saying, hey, if the result is actually valid, so we're manually validating that customer. If it is valid, create the user and return created on that location. But if it is not valid, then we are mapping it to a response contract and we're returning it back to the user. So if I go back and I run it again, just to show you what's happening here, I will go ahead and stick a breakpoint and then go to the create. And let's turn this into an invalid email. So obviously this is not an email. I'm going to say run. That endpoint will be hit. As you can see here, it's going to go through the validate method. It is invalid. And I'm going to press F5. And as you can see, email is not in the correct format because clearly this is not a valid email. It does not satisfy the regex defined here. And you have validation like this for other stuff as well. For example, if the date is in the future, this will not work. Your date cannot be in the future. So we have all that validation there, but we do have to have this piece of code anywhere we need to do that validation. So if I had an update endpoint or any other type of model to validate against, I have to inject a validator of that type on the endpoint and deal with it. If I was to do this with middleware, which exists in minimal APIs, it would be pretty nasty because I would have to check for types and whether this should be validatable or not. And it's just not nice. And there used to be a workaround, but it meant that I had to process the request twice effectively, or the body of the request. Now with filters, watch what I can do. I can go ahead and delete that. So the validator bye-bye. I don't need this. I don't need any of this, right? So that logic is gone. Now I can go here and create a new folder, and I can say filters. And I'm going to create a new filter, calling it validator filter. Here we go. And now this thing will have a generic T-type parameter here, and we're going to add a constraint too. Let me just collapse that. And this will be an iRoute handler filter. And I'm going to say that where T is also class. And now with that filter, I'm going to implement the missing member. And we really have two things here, the route handler invocation context and the route handler filter delegate. So if I was to make this very simple and just do nothing and return, I can say await next and then pass the context in the delegate. And that's it. And if I was to run this, well, nothing would happen. For the record, the way this works is that this happens before the endpoint call when added to an endpoint. And you can say result here equals this and say return result. So this is after endpoint call. And you can at this point before the request short circuit the request itself. So make it exit early and not even go into here. So that's great for validation. The reason why it's great is because through the context, I can access the parameters of that request. And I can check that if the parameter type matches that T-type parameter, I can run the validator generically, which is awesome. Let me show you. All you need to do here is say private read-only iValidator of type T, because we want to validate that object and make it flexible, make it generic. And I'm going to say validator here. And now that I have that injected through the constructor, yes, constructor-based dependency injection works here. So I can grab the validator and say var validatable equals, and I'm going to grab from that context parameters list the thing I want to validate against that matches that type. So I can say single or default where x.getType equals type of T. So with all that, if for some reason validatable is null, which in this case we hope it's not, but if it is null, then return results. So I can actually return from that results object bad request. So, you know, the object wasn't mapped properly, something happened, bad request. You can change this to whatever works for your own API. And then what I can do is I can say await validator.validate async and pass down the validatable. I can actually cast it as T over here, because ultimately that's what I want. So pass the validatable there and say result. This is really the validation result. So let's rename that and say that if validation result is not valid, then return results.badRequest validation result.errors.toResponse. This is an extension method I've written that just maps from one type to the other. Here we go. And once I do that, I have my validation logic here. I can now short circuit the request when validation fails and not even touch that endpoint. So obviously, if I just left it like this and I tried to call the endpoint, it would not work because I didn't actually define my filter anywhere. So what I can do is go here to that post method and say dot add filter with the generic type and say validator filter. I mean, probably validation filter is a better name, but anyway, and then pass down the object I want, so the customer. And that's it. Now, just by chaining the filter to the map method, that's all I need. Now, if I go and I run this, I clearly deleted the validator directly from this, and I can actually just stick a breakpoint here just so you can see. So if I go back, mess up the email address again and run it, as you can see, email is not in the correct format. This is coming from the validation filter. So as you can see, if I call it again, we're hitting in here. We are grabbing the validatable, the customer object in its form, mapped correctly to the generic type that we have from that validator, and then run all the validation. It's not valid and it goes poo-poo. And if it is valid, as you can see here, so nickchapsas.com, if I do that, as you can see, it goes in that endpoint and I can just create my user and that works fine. The user, as you can see, was created. Now, something I should note is that you can actually have multiple filters and they will go sequentially. So the first one will execute first, the second one after that, and so on and so forth. And eventually you're going to end up to the endpoint itself. And if I go here in the program.cs and I say map get hello and pass, let's say an age parameter over here and say int age, and I don't know, say something like I am age years old, then I can have an add filter method. And you saw the generic one, the one where we pass down something that implements the iRoute handler filter interface, but I can also say add filter over here, and then I can have this overload over here, and let's just say CTX here and next. And what I can do here is say async and then context and do one of these where I say return await next context, and I can have this inline approach here too. And I'm going to extract this to a local method, so I'm going to say string handler and do this. The reason why I'm doing this for the video is because they're still working on this, so if I left it in there it wouldn't work, but if I extract it in a local method it does work. Don't worry, by the time this is out this will be working absolutely fine. And now that we have that, I can go debug, and if I just call the endpoint, as you can see it returns the right response over here and it goes through the filter appropriately. So let's just show you this being called in sequence. So this is being called first, this is being called second, and we're getting the response, and you have all the same functionality that you have in that class. In my opinion, it is a better way to structure things properly and separate this in a separate class, but it's nice that maybe for some use cases you can just have an inline filter like this for a very quick check on the filter before you extract it to a class. So that's it. Finally, I got the feature that I really, really wanted, and I'm so happy that they're adding this because I have so, so many use cases for it. I can't wait to see what else we get in .NET 7. Well, that's all I had for you for this video. Thank you very much for watching. Special thanks to my Patreons for making these videos possible. If you want to support me as well, you're going to find the link in the description down below. Leave a like if you like this video, subscribe for more content like this, and ring the bell as well. And I'll see you in the next video. Keep coding.